For thousands of years, people have told stories about strange experiences that we cannot explain. Stories that conflict with our understanding of reality. Some of those stories found their way into print, to be read by hundreds, thousands, or even millions of readers, before being consigned to the oblivion of the archives. In this series, we dust off forgotten newspaper clippings, magazine articles, and letters from the library of the late Gary Mangiacopra, one of the most prolific collectors of strange stories in the world. Join us as we uncover the forgotten secrets of the archive. Exhibit 2 comes from Box 2, Folder 38, Item 1 of the Gary Mangiacopra Archive. Hidden amidst folders dedicated to the subjects of conventional animals, this forgotten gold mine is an assortment of newspaper clippings on mysterious animal anomalies which do not fit into any of the surrounding categories. First, we will explore clippings related to mutant humans. People who, as a result of genetic aberrations, diseases, or external catalysts, developed bizarre inhuman attributes. Next, we will look at stories of inexplicable interactions between humans and animals, from a woman who claimed, with evidence, that she could read the minds of animals, to a colony of bees who refused to leave the coffin of the dead boy who loved them. Finally, we will delve into stories of animals with extraordinary abilities that science cannot explain. Enjoy! Throughout the centuries, human beings have demonstrated a fascination with unusual people who possess the traits of both man and animal. The ancient Mycenaeans told stories about a monster who was half man and half bull, who dwelled in a labyrinth on the island of Crete. Legend has it that the jungles of Uganda are haunted by a demon that is half human and half bat. Some of the most popular superheroes of 20th century comic books are mutant humans imbued with the characteristics of certain animals. And nearly two-thirds of the episodes which comprise the popular TV series, The X-Files, revolve around mutated human predators. One singular family cursed with animalistic characteristics were the Lamberts of Suffolk, England, who stand out in the annals of medical history for a rare, peculiar, and unique condition from which they suffered, for which they were given the moniker Porcupine Men. These individuals, adorned with dark scales, thick quills, and bristles, were marred by a grotesque disease that spared only their faces, palms, soles, and genitalia. The origins of this extraordinary malady within the Lambert family can be traced back to 1715, affecting multiple generations before vanishing inexplicably during the mid-1800s. Remarkably, this condition exclusively targeted males, manifesting several weeks after birth. The first recorded encounter with a porcupine man occurred in 1731, as documented by John Machine, a scientist who observed a 14-year-old boy afflicted by the condition. He described the boy's skin as resembling rugged bark or animal hide, shedding annually to make way for new skin growth. Despite their shocking appearance, the Lambert males led relatively normal lives, even marrying and passing down their harrowing affliction to subsequent generations. They were exhibited as freaks in sideshows, yet seemed to have no difficulty finding spouses, as noted in an 1833 article. Accounts from the 18th and 19th centuries depicted the practical challenges faced by these individuals, such as the rapid wear and tear of bed linens due to their condition and the discomfort caused by the growth of their quills, which could reach a length of 1 inch. However, by the middle of the 19th century, the porcupine men mysteriously vanished from public view, leaving behind a legacy shrouded in enigma. Even eminent dermatologists like Dr. Arthur Rook have expressed limited knowledge about the current existence of this baffling disease. Do you believe in werewolves? According to medical experts, there are likely numerous individuals, potentially numbering in the dozens or even hundreds, living among us who exhibit traits associated with these lupine monsters of European folklore. Dr. Oswald Eben, a medical researcher at the University of Texas, suggests that European werewolf legends may have originated from individuals suffering from a rare and incurable blood disease called porphyria. This hereditary condition, caused by a defective gene, has been linked to cases in the United States. The connection to werewolf folklore is proposed to stem from the fact that some porphyria patients experience excessive facial and body hair growth and are sensitive to light, leading them to predominantly venture outdoors at night. Additionally, these individuals may exhibit symptoms of madness, as explained by Dr. Claus Pierak, an associate professor of medicine at the University of Minnesota. Historically, porphyria has been associated with English monarchs, King George III's famous insanity being attributed to the disease. The origins of the malady can be traced back to the Middle Ages and were particularly prevalent in Eastern Europe during the 18th century, coinciding with an increase in werewolf legends. Notably, different varieties of porphyria have been identified in specific populations, such as South Africans of Dutch descent and individuals in Sweden with origins dating back several centuries. Tragically, many individuals afflicted with porphyria were misunderstood, leading to incarcerations in insane asylums or murders at the hands of fearful villagers. The most severe form of the disease, acute intermittent porphyria, manifests with periodic attacks, accompanied by symptoms like abdominal pain, vomiting, breathing difficulties, and paralysis. Unfortunately, misinterpretation of porphyria symptoms often led to misdiagnosis and improper psychiatric treatment. While there is no known cure for porphyria, treatment options such as infusions of hematin have been developed to manage the condition. From Gothic literature to superhero comics, Western fiction is filled with stories of certain special animals which impart some of their characteristics to the people that they bite. One real-life case of this extraordinary phenomenon may have taken place in the late 19th century in the American state of Oregon, as reported by a contemporary newspaper article. Luther King, a resident of Veterans Home at Roseburg, Oregon, was reportedly plagued by a curious condition in which the image of a snake appeared beneath the skin of his left leg every August. The appearance of this image marked the beginning of an annual transformation in which King would briefly take on baffling serpentine characteristics. This perplexing phenomenon can be traced back to August 3, 1873, when King was bitten by a rattlesnake. Since then, a snake-like form intermittently surfaced under the skin of his leg, commencing at the foot and gradually progressing towards the area where he was bitten, only to vanish afterward. Additionally, markings resembling those of a rattlesnake materialized on his skin every August, exuding a toxic substance which doctors determined to be snake venom. During this period, King's leg became numb and incapacitated, and he experienced temporary blindness, evoking the summertime vision loss of rattlesnakes. Throughout history and across the globe, horns have been viewed as symbols of wisdom and power. From the Haida of the Queen Charlotte Islands, who included horns of power on their interpretations of preternatural entities, to Italian Renaissance master Michelangelo, whose sculpture of Moses bears goat-like horns. Artists the world over have appended these cranial protuberances to their depictions of extraordinary men and animals. In the late 19th and early 20th centuries, reports of remarkable horned men emerged from Africa, fascinating the medical community and capturing public attention. Surgeon J.J. Lamprey of the British Army's medical staff encountered and studied three horned men in the British West African colony, known as the Gold Coast, each with two horns positioned on either side of their noses. Lamprey's encounters included a Fanti man named Kofea, a long-faced youth named Kwasel Jabin, and a 20-year-old man called Kujo Danso, who provided insights into the growth of their horn-like protrusions. These cases, along with several others, were documented in a report by pathologists Drs. George Gould and Walter Pyle, shedding light on the surprisingly frequent occurrence of human horns. One of the most peculiar cases reported by Gould and Pyle was that of Paul Rodriguez, a Mexican porter whose head bore a three-pronged horn with a circumference of 14 inches. In Paris, there was an old woman sporting a horn with a length of 9 inches, which was removed by a celebrated surgeon named Souberblel. The report mentions another elderly French woman with horns growing from her forehead, who presented herself to King Louis XIV at Versailles in 1696. There are many more French cases mentioned in the report, all of them involving elderly or middle-aged women with long, sometimes twisted, horn-like growths measuring up to 10 inches in length. Dr. Chaynard of Baltimore reported encountering an elderly woman with a horn on her nose, resembling that of a rhinoceros. Other noteworthy cases pepper the medical history of the British Isles and the Americas. There is the story of a 75-year-old woman from York, England, who broke a goat-like horn from her face, only for it to regrow. Another report describes the removal of a 7.5-inch horn from the temple of a woman in Edinburgh. Dr. Saxton of New York detailed the removal of several horns from patients' ears, while other protuberances were found on the eyelid, nape of the neck, lower lip, and chin. Dr. Wagstaff of London encountered a horn growing 6 inches below the knee of an 80-year-old woman, which had reached a length of over 14 inches in 40 years. Similarly, a Mexican Indian suffered from a protrusion on the left side of his back, which repeatedly regrew even after multiple removal attempts. Women seem to exhibit a greater frequency of horn growth compared to men, with cases most often reported in individuals over the age of 70. The presence of horns, especially in combination with a tail, has sparked superstition and intrigue, exemplified by the tale of the Hoodoo of Plato, a boy from McLeod County, Minnesota, born with hair all over his body, a tail, horns, and other startling features. Dr. D.S. Lamb, a biologist, proposed an intriguing theory suggesting that the mythological monsters of ancient lore, such as the Cyclops and Cerberus, might have been inspired by actual cases of human deformities. This hypothesis aligns with the prevalence of horned gods and heroes in ancient mythology, adding an intriguing layer to the historical significance of human horn deformities. In the late 20th century, an enigmatic group of wild humans emerged from the dense jungles of Brazil, perplexing scientists and sparking various theories about their origins and nature. Speculations ranged from alien transplants gone awry to the possibility of human extraterrestrial hybrids. The mystery unfolded when ranch hands in the Brazilian state of Mato Grosso, located in the heart of the Amazon rainforest, reported encountering what they called a naked savage on their land. The male, named Thomas, exhibited peculiar traits such as the inability to speak, emitting grunts, and displaying physical characteristics reminiscent of monkeys or apes. Remarkably, members of a local family, the Tellez, managed to coax Thomas out of the jungle and into their ranch through patient and unconventional means, eventually adopting him as one of their own. Another unusual Brazilian with behavioral attributes comparable to Thomas's was Maria de Jesus, a girl of startling appearance which some have described as simian. Born in the city of Belo Horizonte, Maria, like Thomas, was unable to speak, grunting and squatting in a manner akin to that of Africa's great apes. Her body was covered with a thick growth of hair. Maria's mysterious appearance, coupled with the sudden and inexplicable vanishing of her mother's husband, led some Brazilians to speculate that her biological father may not have been human. Among animal lovers, there exists a notion that certain pets develop a psychic bond with the humans who care for them. A powerful emotional connection manifests in extraordinary phenomena that science cannot explain. Dismissed as fantastic by the scientific community, this concept is verified by a thread of reports which have been published in newspapers throughout the decades. History is replete with stories of beloved pets, most often dogs, remaining loyal to their owners even in death. Among the most famous of these is the tale of Bobby, a Skye Terrier owned by John Gray, a night watchman for the Edinburgh City Police. In 1858, when Gray died and was laid to rest in Greyfriars Kirkyard, a cemetery which, incidentally, is supposed to be among the most haunted of its kind in the world, Bobby is said to have taken up residence atop his master's grave, loyally guarding his master's tomb for 14 years. There is a similar story involving George Herbert, the Earl of Carnarvon, whom legend says fell victim to an ancient Egyptian curse on account of his excavation of the tomb of Pharaoh Tutankhamun. In the spring of 1923, Lord Carnarvon cut open a mosquito bite while shaving, resulting in an infection that led to his death. Legend has it that at the moment of his passing in a Cairo hospital, Carnarvon's loyal dog, Susie, let out a mournful howl and dropped dead in Highclere Castle, England, more than 2,200 miles away. Dogs may not be the only animals with the ability to develop profound psychic connections with their masters. One story which supports this idea appeared in the June 18, 1895 issue of the Dollar Weekly News Dealer, a newspaper based out of the city of Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, involving a strange event which occurred at a funeral near the city of Parsons, Kansas. As the article explains, the little son of Samuel Carson, residing southwest of the city, died and was buried in the neighborhood cemetery. There being no horse, the remains were placed in a spring wagon and conveyed to the cemetery. On the way to the grave, a swarm of bees gathered on the lid of the coffin and there remained. When the cemetery was reached, all efforts to drive the bees from the coffin were without avail, and the pallbearers were forced to take charge of the coffin with the bees swarming about them. And before the remains were deposited in the grave, every pallbearer suffered, being stung in more than one place on the face and hands. The bees clung so tenaciously to the coffin that many of them were buried with the body of the dead boy. The dead boy was very fond of bees, and whether the bees were thus showing their grief over the loss of their young friend, or what the significance of such an act on the part of the bees was, is a mystery yet unsolved. Another animal which literally followed its master to the grave was a homing pigeon owned by Louis W. Balestrino of Memphis, Tennessee, whose tale is told in a short article in the September 4, 1929 issue of the Washington Post. During a fishing accident that autumn, 19-year-old Louis tragically drowned. While his body reposed in his home, awaiting burial, the homing pigeon, which the young man had raised from a hatchling, left its roost, circled the house in which its master lay, and dropped dead on the porch. The article claimed that the pigeon was buried in the same casket as Balestrino. Such stories suggest the possibility that certain animals possess a sort of extrasensory perception, or ESP, which science has yet to explain. One proponent of this philosophy is George Laycock, author of the 1980 book, Does Your Pet Have a Sixth Sense? In his book, Laycock delves into the intriguing claims that pets may possess a remarkable ability which enables them to anticipate danger and comprehend human thoughts. According to Laycock, people who own pets have long observed that certain animals perform extraordinary acts that seem to require senses beyond those commonly known to humans. The author documents a wealth of evidence gathered by scientists regarding animal ESP, particularly focusing on the uncanny abilities of cats and dogs. The most captivating claim put forth in the book is the concept of psi-trailing, which refers to the ability of animals to travel great distances, sometimes spanning thousands of miles, to reunite with their owners in places they have never been before. These accounts include heartwarming stories of pets locating their owners even after they had moved to new homes where the pets had never previously been. Laycock emphasizes that the senses utilized by the animals who perform these feats are not the common ones known to humans. However, he asserts that these abilities are as real for the animals possessing them as hearing and sight. One fascinating account from the Institute for Parapsychology in North Carolina tells of a cat whose owner, a veterinarian, relocated from New York to California. Before departing for his new home, the owner entrusted his cat to a friend in the same neighborhood. Surprisingly, despite the 3,000-mile distance and 5 months passing, the cat arrived at the front entrance of the veterinarian's California home. Upon entering, the cat went directly to a chair it had always favored and settled down for a nap. Although one might naturally question whether this newcomer was a doppelganger of the vet's old pet, the veterinarian noted that the cat was the same size as his pet and had markings that appeared identical. Another remarkable tale of PSI trailing involves an Irish setter named Jessie, who lived with her owner, Jack Milliken, on his farm near Elgin, Illinois. While traveling together on a road trip to the Rocky Mountains, a distressing incident occurred near Lincoln, Nebraska on an exceptionally hot day in June 1977. Milliken suddenly blacked out on account of the heat, resulting in his car running off the road and crashing into the ditch. Upon regaining consciousness in a hospital, Milliken inquired immediately about his dog, but nobody could recall seeing her anywhere. Following his release from the hospital, Milliken tirelessly searched for Jessie at the scene of the accident. Despite the accounts of a few individuals who reported seeing the large Irish setter lingering in the vicinity, no substantial information could be gleaned. Unfortunately, after 4 months with no sign of the dog, Milliken abandoned his trip and returned to Illinois, eventually relocating to his parents' residence in Elgin, a place Jessie had frequented on numerous occasions. Remarkably, 6 months to the day after the accident, while Millican was away at work, his brother encountered a familiar sight in the backyard. There, sniffing around the spot where the doghouse had originally stood, was the beloved Irish setter, Jesse, who joyfully bounded up to greet him. Later that day, Millican and Jesse were reunited. The dog owner presumed that Jesse, following Millican's trip to the hospital, had first returned to the farm. When she could not find her owner there, the loyal dog traveled the additional 20 miles to Elgin, the other place she associated with her master. Although the canine traveler was gaunt and weary, with a filthy coat and sore feet, she quickly regained her health. Another strange tale about an epic animal journey features a feline wanderer named Cochise, who set out on an astonishing odyssey which culminated in a miraculous reunion with its human family. The saga began with Cochise's disappearance in March 1979, an inexplicable event which left the cat's family, the Ayosas of Spring Valley, Rockland County, bereft and despondent. 4 long years passed, and just as hope began to fade, fate intervened. On a dark Tuesday night, as Mrs. Barbara Ayosa returned home, she was greeted by a sight that defied belief, a familiar feline figure in the backyard. One glance at the weathered yet unmistakable visage confirmed the impossible. It was Cochise, their long-lost companion. The cat bore the marks of his tumultuous journey, which complemented battle scars earned in his youth and other distinguishing features that left no doubt as to his identity. Thin and in need of care, yet surprisingly resilient, Cochise had traveled 15 miles to find his way back home. The joyous reunion marked a new chapter in Cochise's life as he resumed his place as the cherished pet of the Ayosa children, bringing renewed happiness to the family. Despite the elation, the details of Cochise's extraordinary voyage remained shrouded in mystery, leaving the family to wonder about the enigmatic circumstances that had led to this remarkable homecoming. As Mrs. Ayosa remarked, "We don't have a clue how he got here, where he's been living, or how he found us. I guess we'll never know, but he sure looks good to us." Another newspaper article recounts a similar story involving a mutt named Benson, who ran off from his owner, Roger Holiday of Bisbee, Arizona, during a visit to Montrose more than 500 miles away. Holiday searched for his canine companion to no avail. Finally conceding that his dog was gone for good, he reluctantly returned to Bisbee. 9 months later, while relating the story of his lost mutt to a humane officer, he learned that a dog matching Benson's description had been found at the edge of the desert, stubbornly clinging to life. Holiday rushed to the pound and sure enough, found his beloved dog, scrawny and mangy, yet very much alive. Despite his pitiful condition, the loyal mutt let out a joyous yelp when he saw his master. Holiday wished he knew the details of Benson's odyssey across 500 miles of Arizona desert. "But he just won't talk about it," he said. A similar story revolves around Buddy, a 7-year-old collie shepherd who embarked upon an extraordinary journey spanning over 1,000 miles in a poignant quest to reunite with his master. His wilderness trek began when his owner, Eldon Hopperstad, relocated from Shaftesbury, Vermont to Grand Prairie, Texas. In order to attend class at a local Bible school, Hopperstad was obliged to leave his canine companion at home during his first night in the Lone Star State. Overwhelmed by the sudden separation, Buddy escaped the house and commenced an incredible journey homeward bound. After nearly 2 months of solitary travel, Buddy was discovered in Putnam County, New York, a testament to his unyielding resolve and remarkable navigational prowess. Sari Whalen of the Putnam County Humane Society recounted this captivating tale of canine fortitude, emphasizing that Buddy's deliberate journey suggested an inexplicable familiarity with the direction to Vermont, defying conventional explanations of animal behavior. Despite his temporary capture, Buddy's resolute spirit led him to repeatedly evade captivity, leaping over fences in a relentless pursuit of his intended destination. "He was a dog who was really determined," Mrs. Whalen declared. "He was going somewhere." Ultimately, through the diligent efforts of the Humane Society officials and with the aid of modern transportation, Buddy was successfully reunited with his owner, thanks to a heartwarming initiative that arranged a free plane ride for the devoted canine on Braniff International Airlines. Another tale of dogged dog determination features an intrepid German shepherd named Jess, who made an astonishing journey of 2,200 miles from Colorado to Rhode Island, apparently in an effort to reach his old home. The saga began when Jess left his owners, Daryl and Dorotney Gardner, and relocated with the Gardner's son, Jexter, to the rocky mountain city of Aspen. After months of lonely house-sitting while Jexter was at work, Jess decided to take matters into his own paws, escaping his domestic prison and commencing his remarkable cross-country trek, which culminated with his poignant reunion with the elder Gardners. Recounting the emotional homecoming of his old canine companion, Gardner said, "He was crying. He pushed his head into my stomach, almost knocking me over. It was just overpowering." The palpable longing for his absent friend Dexter was evident in Jess's behavior, a sentiment echoed by Gardner's wife Dorothy, who remarked, "I think he's still looking for Dexter. He hangs around the VW that Dexter used to drive." Jess's epic journey serves as a poignant testament to the enduring bond between pets and their human companions, serving as a reminder of the unyielding spirit and unwavering devotion of man's best friend. Can animals predict natural disasters? For centuries, people all over the world have observed that certain creatures seem to have an uncanny ability to foretell seismic events like earthquakes and tsunamis, for which science has yet to provide a conclusive explanation. In the summer of 1976, in the vicinity of the Chinese city of Sungpan, an array of unusual occurrences heralded the impending seismic upheaval. Swarms of minor tremors, accompanied by jarring, sporadic jolts, unsettled the region. The very earth shifted, altering the landscape, while peculiar changes in the water supply, including altered taste and evaporated springs, signaled a disturbance beneath the surface. Nature itself seemed to mirror the impending calamity, with unprecedented phenomena such as double blooming of peach trees, withering bamboo, and unusual animal behavior. Rats began to scale telephone poles, pigs displayed uncharacteristic restlessness, and birds began to evacuate the region on a spontaneous mass exodus. In response to these telling signs, scientists in Sichuan province issued a forewarning of an impending major earthquake, prompting the evacuation of several million individuals from vulnerable structures and the establishment of emergency facilities to mitigate the anticipated impact. Subsequently, as prophesied, a significant earthquake struck the area on August 16, 1976, validating the accuracy of the seismic predictions. This was followed by two additional warnings, each preceding subsequent tremors that further affirmed the precision of the forecasts. Following a delegation of American researchers to China, Robert Wallace, the chief seismologist at the U.S. Geological Survey's National Center for Earthquake Research, lauded his Chinese counterparts, acknowledging their seismic prediction program as the most successful in the world. Despite advancements in earthquake prediction, the Chinese program stood out for its unparalleled accuracy and efficacy. China's practice of basing seismic predictions on animal activity mirrors an ancient art long practiced by the Japanese, namely, the observation of catfish. There is an old Japanese legend which holds that the island of Honshu rests on the back of a giant sleeping catfish, which causes earthquakes to ripple throughout the land of the rising sun every time it stirs. According to Japanese scientists, the myth may be attributable to the catfish's ability to foretell earthquakes with an astounding 100% accuracy. The diligent members of the Namazu no Kai, also known as the Catfish Society in Chiba City, Japan, have achieved remarkable success by accurately predicting a succession of earthquakes which rocked Japan in the 1970s and 80s, with one prediction made within an astonishing 6 minutes of the actual seismic event. The insightful observers of the Catfish Society keenly monitor the behavioral cues exhibited by catfish, often detecting subtle changes up to a full day before the occurrence of an earthquake. This advanced warning system enables them to promptly alert fire departments and emergency squads, allowing for preemptive readiness when the tremors commence. Ruth Buskirk, a biologist at the University of Texas, affirmed the scientific basis for observing catfish movements to forecast earthquakes, stating, "Some animals hear sounds at very low frequencies, smell gases escaping from the ground, and even sense minute changes in the Earth's electric fields. These conditions can be potential warnings that an earthquake is on the way. Minute changes in the Earth's electric field may alert some fish, and catfish have responded to such changes." While the Catfish Society in Chiba City operates with only 7 catfish under observation, the city of Yokohama, back in the 1980s, wholeheartedly embraced this concept by distributing free catfish to elementary school children. These young observers were encouraged to diligently monitor the behavior of the fish, maintain records, and report any unusual behavioral patterns they noticed. Another animal with the purported ability to predict earthquakes before they happen is the pigeon. According to Dr. Melvin Creathan of the University of Pittsburgh, pigeons have a remarkable sensitivity to vibrations, which enables them to perceive earthquake warning signs long before humans become aware of them, which they react to with fear and restlessness. Another popular theory which purports to explain pigeons' seismic forecasting abilities is that these city-dwelling birds are able to sense the electromagnetic shifts in the atmosphere which often precede earthquakes. Another critter supposed by some to have the ability to predict impending seismic activity is the domestic dog. An article in the January 26, 1981 issue of Connecticut's Bridgeport Post tells the tale of a Doberman Pinscher from Ohio, which may have predicted an earthquake that shook California 20 hours later. "On the porch, off the porch, bark, bark, bark," said owner Mark Holthouse of his pooch's strange behavior. And for no reason at all, Holthouse warned his neighbors to prepare for an earthquake. Sure enough, 20 hours after his dog's inexplicable antics, a quake registering 4.7 on the Richter scale ripped through the United States. albeit along the California-Nevada border, 1,900 miles away. Scientists who commented on the story were divided as to whether the guard dog's outburst was truly a prediction of the earthquake or simply too far away to possibly have any connection with it. There are other articles in Box 2, Folder 38, Item 1 of the Gary Mangiacopra Archives, including a solitary report of a feathered serpent evoking a deity of Pan-American tradition, a piece chronicling a development in the saga of Jeff the Talking Mongoose from the Isle of Wight, which we touched on in a previous piece, reports of huge unidentified worms that dwell at the bottom of the South Pacific Ocean, and articles describing a mysterious species of ungulate found in the mountains of the American Southwest. If you would like to read these stories and other items in the Gary Mangiacopra archive, please click on the link in the description.